Hello, my name is Xiangwan. Today, with Jason, we're happy to share our thoughts on how you can build with O1. So O1 is a reasoning model, and we train O1 to think with reinforcement learning. And during the training phase, it learns, among other things, to refine the thinking strategies and recognize and correct its mistakes. So when O1 attempts to solve a very difficult problem, it may not get to the working strategy in one go. But just by trying a strategy, even if it's unsuccessful, can give some cues as to what to try next. And so O1 does this, and then eventually it gets to the better strategy and so on. So it's very patient, and it's a very different type of model. And so last month when we released O1 preview, we had showed some of the examples of actual chain of thought going on. So in this particular example, we have the cipher text. The model is trying to decipher some kind of a text. And I'll show you some reasoning patterns. So in this case, the model says, So probably it's like recognizing that this current thinking strategy is not really leading to anywhere, and probably trying something different. In this case, the model tries something out and then says, wait a minute. So it's probably realizing slightly better approach and then trying that next. And then in this case, the model has more concrete idea to try out. So it says, let's test this theory. And if after a while, model gets to a more correct situation, correct like a strategy, and says it's perfect. So the model behavior is very, very different. And in fact, it's so different that we believe O1 represents a new paradigm. And new paradigm changes so many things that I think we should think about having a new perspective. So what really changes? I think a good starting point to think about this question is where we were, and then where we are now, and where we're heading towards. And so I invite you to think about questions like these. What just became possible with O1 that wasn't really possible with the previous generations of the model? And what will become possible with the future versions of O1? And obviously, the answers to these questions will be very different depending on the specific domain. But just thinking about these questions will put you into a mode of thinking where, OK, now we're building with the future models in mind, instead of thinking that the current generations of the model will stay as is. So you might say, OK, I'm not building O1 myself, so how do I know what future generations of the O1 might look like? Unlike the previous paradigms, O1 paradigm is much simpler in that it's a reasoning model, so its reasonings will be just better, meaning that it will be able to think better in pretty much anything that requires thinking. So with that, I think it's useful to think about when you're building something, considering questions like this. What would you want to build if reasoning is 50% better than what we have now? What would you want to do differently? And then maybe more importantly, what would you not want to build if reasoning is 50% better? And we have seen in many cases that as the model gets generally smarter, some of the problems that we think are difficult in the past just became trivially possible. So if we believe that the reasoning will just continually get better, we should think about what problems to not solve as well. So with this new paradigm, I have been working for a while, but I'm still really having some trouble because I'm so used to the previous paradigm of, and so I think this is really useful. I hope this sparks some interest in thinking about how to build with this new reasoning paradigm. With that, I'll pass it on to Jason.
Thanks, Xiangwan. I wanted to talk a little more specifically. I wanted to talk a little more specifically about a few evals that we've shown in the blog post that might guide you for when you might want to use O1 and O1 preview compared to GPT-4o. So I think one of the best use cases for models in the O1 paradigm are for extremely hard math and code problems. So you'll see in these bar charts, we have on the left IME, which is competition math, and on the right code forces. And there's these three bars, so GPT-4o in teal, O1 preview, and then O1. And the thing to note here is that GPT-4o and o1 Preview are barely solving a few questions in these benchmarks. And then you could see o1 Preview can solve more than half, and o1 can solve the majority of problems in this data set. So the point is there's some subset of tasks where GPT-4o is really struggling, o1 can solve the majority of problems. Here's a broader evaluation suite that we published in the blog post. And I'll highlight a few things here. So first, if you look at the performance on some of the math benchmarks, so math from Hendrix, physics, college math, LSAT, there's a huge performance gain when you use o1 Preview compared to GPT-4o. And then conversely, you don't get a huge performance gain for every task. So there's some tasks like AP English Language, Literature, SAT, Public Relations, where we actually don't see o1 Preview doing a lot better than GPT-4o. And so I made this table that sort of summarizes when you might want to use models from the o1 paradigm versus GPT-4o. So I would say the pros of using models from o1 Preview and o1 is if you're trying to do tasks that are extremely challenging prompts and in their domains of science, math, and coding. And the other use case would be if you don't care about any other constraints and you just want the best answer, then o1 will likely be the most performant model generally. The cons here are obviously that because as Hyungwon mentioned, o1 Preview and o1 require time to think. It's going to be a lot more expensive, and there's going to be a much higher latency when you use these models. And then for GPT-4o, I would say that's still great for the majority of use cases that people are currently using the API for. Obviously, it's less expensive and lower latency than o1 Preview and o1. And I guess the con would be that it's weaker than o1 on prompts that require reasoning or strong coding or math. And then there's the question of when should you use o1 Preview versus o1 Mini? And this plot here shows the inference cost versus performance of a few of these models. So you can see the inference cost on the x-axis, and then on the y-axis is performance on IME, which is competition math. And interestingly, we see that o1 Mini is actually strictly better than o1 Preview. And this is because we really specialized o1 Mini to be a fast but performant model on things like math and coding. And I would say you should use o1 Mini if you're doing math or coding, or if you want the answer more quickly or cheaply. But I would say in other cases, o1 Preview is a good choice. Finally, I wanted to highlight a few use cases in the API of o1 Preview and o1 Mini. So I like this one from the OpenAI cookbook here. It's basically a medical inaccuracy detection. So you're given a bunch of information and diagnosis. And then o1 Preview tries to detect whether it's a correct diagnosis or not. Obviously, coding is another great example of o1 Preview shining. So for use cases like Cursor, I think o1 Preview would do a great job. Hard sciences research is another great use case that o1 Preview is particularly strong at. And we've also heard that these models have been good as a brainstorming partner on math problems or on legal domain reasoning. So I'll end here and enjoy using o1 Preview and o1 Mini. Thank you.